Now, in the United States, a lot of this debate is being talked about in terms of metadata. You might have heard this term. One of the things President Obama said to make everyone feel better is, don't worry, it's only metadata. And by that he means, we're not listening on the contents of your phone calls, although you're not American, so they probably are. But for us, they've said, I guess this is really for Americans, we're not listening on your phone calls, we are just collecting the metadata. You know, who you called, when you called, how long you talked, where you were. And metadata is an interesting term. Metadata is data about data. It's data that the computer system uses to process the communications. Now, I don't think that should make people feel better. Metadata fundamentally equals surveillance. And there's an easy way to think about this. Imagine that I hired a private detective to follow this guy. That detective would put a bug in his car, in his home, in his office, and I'd get a report. I'd get a report of the conversations he had. Right? That's the data. That's what President Obama said is not being done regularly. But imagine I hired a different detective to put him under surveillance. And I get a different report. Where he went, who he spoke to, what he read, what he looked at. That's all metadata. Metadata is surveillance data. And in aggregate, it's much more important than the conversations. The metadata tracks relationships, it tracks associations, it shows what we're interested in, it shows what's important to us. It really does reveal who we are to a very intimate degree. And in the age of computers, metadata is much easier to store, to search, to analyze. And we know a bit about the NSA analysis tools for metadata. We had some interesting examples from cell phone location data. So the NSA collects cell phone location data of, we're not sure who, we think pretty much everybody on the planet they can, and keeps it in a large database, and they do lots of analysis of this data. So, for example, they will look at phones, which tracks individuals, who travel near each other physically. It's a program called Cold Travel, and it's a way for them to figure out associations that don't show up in the communications data. So if he and I never text and email or phone call, but we happen to meet today, that can be recorded. Maybe we met three times during the day. Because one could be a chance meeting, but multiple times probably isn't. An interesting program, and this is actually very clever, where they will look for phones that turn off and then turn on an hour or so later, and then look for other phones geographically nearby that do the same thing. So if you have a secret meeting, one of the things you might do is turn your phone off. Well, they can correlate for that. They have another system where they'll look for phones that are used, get turned off and never used again, and another phone gets turned on quickly thereafter in the same geographical location and then used. So they look for burner phones. And these are all techniques to take the data, there's a lot of these, to take this data and look for things of surveillance interest. And in this way, I think the debate is largely mischaracterized. We spend a lot of time, certainly in the US, talking about streams of data. We talk about cell phone location data, we talk about email data, we talk about cameras and data for cameras. And we spend a lot less time talking about the analysis. And all the data together. So telephone metadata plus email contact lists plus email capture. Or drones plus automatic face recognition plus Facebook's tagged photo database. Right? Or the system NSA uses to identify computer systems and phone location tracking. And a lot of this together is far more sophisticated than is discussed in the media. And of course, even though this is about the NSA and the documents we have is about the NSA, this isn't about the NSA. This is what every nation state is doing to the ability of their technical capability and their budget. Now, the United States has a privileged position on the internet. You know, for several reasons. A lot of the internet backbone goes through the US. Right? The government in Brazil was quite shocked to learn that when they communicate with Europe, it all goes through Florida. And, you know, surprising amount of communications go through the US. Even things that geographically might not make sense, they make sense in the routing to go through the United States. So we have a privileged position on the net. A lot of the major internet companies are American, so we have a privileged position legally. But this is really what any well-funded nation-state adversary would do. You know, we know similar things are done in China. We know similar things are done in Russia. We know of a lot of surveillance, government surveillance equipment manufacturers that sell surveillance equipment into a litany of third world countries. And some of the ones you mentioned, Ethiopia, Azerbaijan, Vietnam, Syria, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, I mean, lists of 20 and 30 countries that have some of these capabilities. Yeah, and we see it in even the detail tech. You know, there's, I don't know if you heard the term Stingray. Stingray is basically it's a fake cell phone tower. And this is something made by Harris Corporation, an American company, sold to the FBI in the United States, that's used to basically capture your information, who you're calling, your location, by putting up a fake tower. And so this is something the U.S. government does for criminal investigations. We learned about a month ago that there are, I don't know, 30, 40, 50 towers in the Washington, D.C. area that are owned by, we're not sure who. That someone else, probably another government, maybe not, is putting up these towers and using them to collect data on probably U.S. government communications. Might we know these fake cell phone towers are being sold to many countries to do the same thing? And we know there are turnkey surveillance systems that are sold. You mentioned Facebook posts. It's been very common in third world countries now for Facebook to be monitored, for email to be monitored. And they're all through a lot of these systems. One of the very secret programs that the NSA had was called Quantum. And I'll sort of spare the details. Quantum is a program by which the NSA sits on the internet backbone, sits in the middle, and intercepts your communications. So let's say you're going to Facebook, and the NSA will see that go by and respond with a fake Facebook page faster than the real Facebook. And they can do that because they're good and they're in a good position on the internet. And by doing that, they will hack into people's computers. It is a very subtle attack. It's hard to defend against. And it's something the NSA does. That's called a quantum program. Since that became public last October, much to the consternation of the NSA, we learned that other governments are doing the same thing, the Chinese government is, and now there is a company called Hacking Team, they're an Italian company, that will sell the same capability to, near as we can tell, any government that will pay. And so the same capability that was once a top secret NSA program is now used by governments around the world. And we see this again and again. I can list many examples of this. That the way to look at these NSA programs are a preview of what other governments will do next year and criminals will do in 2 or 3 years. Right, that fundamentally, these capabilities flow downhill. Right, today's secret programs are tomorrow's PhD theses and the next day's hacking tools.